That's how you change the world. Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic. Let's pray.
Father, we are so grateful for your mercy, so grateful for the grace and the love and the forgiveness that you have bestowed upon all of us who have put our faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. We're thankful for his shed blood that has reconciled us back unto you, a holy God. We're thankful for your word this morning that demonstrates for us and reveals to us how we can live in response to that salvation in a way that brings you glory and pleasure. And so as we open up your word today, God, I pray that our hearts would be open, that we might receive all that you would speak to us through your Spirit, Father. And we ask to be changed by your word, to be molded into who it is that you desire us to be. And so, Lord, bless our time, bless our study, anoint your word now. We offer this time to you. We ask for your presence in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated, and let's all turn together in our Bibles to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 as we continue our study through the Bible. Paul, in the last chapter, was in the middle of exhorting and encouraging and expressing how proud he was of the Thessalonian church. But in the middle of that, he felt like he needed to defend himself, and mainly to defend the gospel against some of the false claims that the Judaizers were levying against him and his ministry. They were saying things like Paul was delusional and he was a deceiver, that he was only in ministry for the money, and that his heart was not for the people. And Paul reminded the Thessalonians, he said, listen, none of you guys can question my heart related to my desire and my resolve to share the truth of the gospel. He said, I came to you with the same truth of the gospel that had just gotten me severely beaten in Philippi. I came to you with a back that was already torn to shreds because of my love for you and because of my commitment for you to know the truth at any cost. And Paul says, when I came, I demanded nothing from you. I supported myself. I came to you with the simple truth. No fancy words, no song and dance, no sales pitch, just the truth. And the truth, as it always does, it's going to fall on those who will hear it and receive it, but then there are always going to be those where they reject the truth and they're in such opposition to the truth that they seek to oppress and persecute those who champion it. But Paul says, regardless of how they persecuted me, he said, I treated the people of Thessalonica like you were my own children. And he called God to the witness stand in that regard. He said, God is my witness as to the motivation of my heart toward you. In fact, Paul says, my greatest reward in ministry, my greatest joy in being someone who communicates the truth to others is when I see people come to a surrendering to that truth, putting their faith in Jesus Christ. Paul says, my greatest joy and my reward is seeing you in heaven. And you remember how Paul talked about just how much he had desired to go back to that church in Thessalonica and to be able to minister to that church in person, but how each time Satan had intervened and stopped him. And that's where we pick up our study here in chapter 3. Therefore, he says, verse 1, when we could no longer endure it, man, when I just couldn't stand it, I had to know what was happening with the church there in Thessalonica, and when we could no longer endure it, we thought it good to be left in Athens alone. Now remember, Paul was traveling with Silas and Timothy, and when Paul had went to Athens, he didn't stay there very long. He moved very quickly to the city of Corinth, but during his time ministering in Athens, he was so concerned with the church in Thessalonica, that he was willing to make sacrifices, or the sacrifice of not having his young protege Timothy there with him in Athens, so that he could send Timothy back to minister to the church in Thessalonica. So if Paul couldn't go back there, then the next best thing was to send Timothy. And it says, we thought it good to be left in Athens alone and sent Timothy, our brother and minister of God and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ. Our brother, he's a believer, a minister of God, which just means that Timothy was a servant of God and God's people. And then the word for laborer communicates that Timothy was a very hard worker, that he was diligent. And so, obviously, he was a very valuable asset to Paul's ministry. But Paul says, I sent Timothy to you, as we'll see, with a twofold purpose. Number one, to establish you, he says. And then number two, encourage you concerning your faith. Now, you remember how Paul, when he planted the church in Thessalonica, he was only able to minister there, we're told, in Acts for three Sabbaths, three weeks before he was run out of town by an angry mob. And so in his mind, he planted the church there, but then he had to leave, and he left a church full of baby Christians, a bunch of people who had come to a saving faith in Jesus Christ, but they're like, okay, I'm saved, now what? Now what do I do? And Paul saw himself as a parent, like a mother and a father, all in one to the Thessalonian church, as he communicated last week. And a mother, once she has given birth to her child, as hard and as painful as that is, so I'm told, she doesn't just give birth and then look at her baby and say, well, I did my part. I brought you into this world. Good luck from here on out. I mean, it's tough out there. Giving birth is just the beginning of the mothering process. She then has to raise up that child and nurture the child, protect it. She has to give that child all that it needs in order for it to become a mature adult and a protective member of society. And that's the way Paul felt about the Thessalonian church. He knew that new believers have to be established. They have to be trained and instructed in the ways of the Lord. That's why you're sitting here today, or hopefully. When God saves and delivers people, he expects those people to go and live a drastically different kind of life than they did before he saved them. But how do I know what that drastically different kind of life looks like from God's perspective? How do I know what holiness looks like unless I am taught? And what is it then that teaches me how to walk in holiness? What is it that communicates to me God's heart? What is it that's going to establish me walking like someone who is a disciple of Christ? Well, it's the Word of God. God has revealed himself, his character, his essence, everything that we need to know about God and what he has done for us, what he expects of us. It's all in the Word of God. When Jesus was tempted by Satan, what did he use to defeat him? The Word of God. Paul exhorted the Ephesians. You remember our study of Ephesians. Paul exhorted them to take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, to take up that Word of God in their battle against Satan and the demonic forces. Hebrews 4:12 says, for the Word of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow. And it says it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. In other words, a working knowledge of the Bible is vital. It's essential for spiritual growth. And we live in a day where everybody's heard the term seeker-friendly movement. We live in the seeker-friendly movement day within the church. And to be seeker-friendly, make no mistake about it, means that you have to be Bible unfriendly. Church, for most people, unfortunately, has become all about mood and atmosphere, lights and music, and where can I go to church, you know, to get the best latte. And you know, a lot of people think that church is church, and it doesn't matter where you go as long as you go somewhere. And I couldn't disagree more. Now, I don't have anything against lights and good music. And I don't have anything against being able to get a good latte at church. There's nothing wrong with that. But make no mistake about it, you can show up to any building with a cross on it every Sunday morning, but if you haven't been taught the Word of God inductively, meaning here's what the Bible says, here's what it means, and here's how you take it and apply it to your life. The three elements of inductive study, which is observation, interpretation, application. So you can call the building that you're meeting in every Sunday morning whatever you want to call it, but if you haven't been taught the Word of God in a way that you can internalize it and have it change you from the inside out, then you haven't been to church. God's Word is food to nourish us. It's a light to guide us. It's a weapon. It's a shield. It's everything that we need related to instructions in holiness. It's everything that we need related to how we can live our most productive, most fulfilled life. And without it, without the Word of God, at best, we might be saved, but we'd be a church full of malnourished, blind, powerless, disoriented babies is what we would be. The Word of God is essential in the lives of believers. And I don't mean just taking a verse or two here and there every Sunday morning. I mean the whole entire Word of God. If God wrote it, He meant for us to read it and understand it. All right? I've had people come up and say, you know, I appreciate Calvary Chapels and even this church in particular, but you know, the standard is just too high for me here. I need to go somewhere else, you know, where, you know, I'm not held to such a high standard, as if it's the church that sets the standard for holiness. Listen, God sets the standard for holiness in His Word. And just because you go to a church who doesn't, you know, hold you to that standard of holiness doesn't mean that God's not going to hold you just as accountable. So the Word of God is essential in the lives of believers, and thus any church that doesn't put the Word of God as its central focus is robbing its people out of God's best, robbing its people out of their most fulfilling and most gratifying lives. Now, I want to challenge you. Listen, every week, the beginning of the week starts with, you know, Monday through Thursday. I try to take Friday as my Sabbath sometimes. But every week from those 4 days is God challenging me through His Word. And then God giving me the privilege to come and to teach either on Wednesday night or Sunday morning. And hopefully you're challenged every single week. And that God's heart and God's love for you, God's grace for you, but God's standard is being revealed through his Word. When Timothy was serving as the pastor of the church in Ephesus, Paul was Timothy's mentor. And Paul wrote to him in order to instruct him and encourage him in how to be an effective pastor. And the main theme of Paul's instructions in that letter for Timothy, we find in 2 Timothy 4, verses 1 through 3. Now listen to this. Paul says, I charge you, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at His appearing and His kingdom, I charge you to what? Preach the Word. Now notice the exclamation point. I didn't say that right. What he said was, preach the Word. We are to consistently gather together as God's people. And when we do gather together, we worship, we pray, we fellowship, we encourage one another. Those are all important aspects of the church service. But the main focus of the church experience better be centered around the Word of God. Otherwise, the church is nothing but a social gathering. Paul says, be ready in season and out of season. And what are the three things that the Word sets out to accomplish in a human heart? The Word convinces, it rebukes, and it exhorts. In other words, it instructs me in holy living with all long suffering and teaching. And then notice Paul warns of the seeker-friendly movement that would infiltrate the church in the last days. He says, for the time will come when they, the people, not the teachers, but the people, will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. They're gonna go to places where the pastors are not only going to tell them what they want to hear, pastors are going to ignore and not speak out of God's word what they don't want to hear. I'm not going to talk about sin and hell, and not going to talk about condemnation, not going to talk about, you know, God's standard for holiness, not going to talk about what God expects of each of us, you know, having saved us and bought us, purchased us with a price, and that price being his own blood. And Paul here reminds the Thessalonian church of how he had sent Timothy to establish them, to grow them up in the word, to grow them up in the Lord. And then the second purpose of sending Timothy was so that he could encourage them in their faith. And notice, encouragement can only come after that church had been well established in the word. Otherwise, you can have a church full of encouraging people, but if they don't know the word, they're going to encourage you in the wrong direction. You can have zeal for the word and for church, but if you don't know the word, then your zeal is going to be misguided. Paul said, I wanted you to be established. I wanted you to have a firm foundation in the word. And I wanted you to be encouraged as God's people. But I also wanted to equip you to be able to not only be encouraged, but to be encouragers. It's important that the church as a whole develops an atmosphere of encouragement. Who wants to go to a church where everybody's complaining? Who wants to go to a church where, you know, everybody's woe is me and look around that's going on and COVID and you know, Democrats and liberalism and blah, you know, no offense if you're a Democrat, but the two main purposes of the church is that we would grow in the word together, and that we would grow in the Lord together, and that we would be able to lean on one another, and we would be able to stand together. Now, why is that important, especially in our day? Because it's a rough world. Because there are afflictions. Look, he said, verse 3, that no one should be shaken by these afflictions. Now, that word shaken is the same word that is used in the Bible for how a dog wags its tail. Without the knowledge of the word and without a strong support system, without the support and the fellowship of the brethren, that's what our faith would look like. Where our faith, you know, okay, one minute's up, next minute it's down, one minute's here, it's there, you know, it's all over the place, it's all around. Like a dog inadvertently wagging its tail with no sense or no point in direction. Where I might be going along in my faith, but then as soon as I hit some kind of speed bump, I hit some kind of trial, I'm like, what's happening? Is God mad at me? I get sick, I get diagnosed with, you know, whatever, and I'm like, what's going on, God? I thought you loved me. And each time, you know, my faith is shaken. Whereas if I were familiar enough with the Word of God, and I have surrounded myself with people who are going to encourage me in the word, then I would know what is happening, these speed bumps, these afflictions. I would know that it's just all par for the course related to the Christian life. So I wouldn't be shaken when it happens. As Christians, we're going to face afflictions and persecutions. Paul says, for you yourselves know that we were appointed to this. You're writing in your Bible, circle that word, appointed. You know firsthand, if you've been walking with Jesus for more than 2 weeks, you know that you've got a big bullseye on your back that the enemy is taking aim at. So the idea is, as a Christian, we don't get to avoid afflictions. And when afflictions do hit, we don't, you know, we don't point our finger at God and get angry and upset with God. Something's gone wrong. God's lost control or whatever. We don't get saved and then all of a sudden become immune to afflictions. Just the opposite. What does the Bible say? 2 Timothy 3:12. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will escape persecution. No, that's not what it says. It says will suffer persecution. Why? Why am I going to suffer persecution in this world? Well, because this world's not my home. I don't belong here. I'm just passing through. I'm a citizen of heaven. And the God of this world doesn't like the fact that I'm a citizen of heaven, that I haven't submitted myself to the cares and the woes of this world. He's diametrically opposed to anyone who is a citizen of heaven. So, if I can't escape worldly afflictions, and I can't, then I better learn how to endure them, right? I better learn how to get the right perspective and attitude related to these things. And how do I do that? How do I get the right perspective? How do I learn how to endure afflictions? By familiarizing myself with the Word of God, number one, being plugged into a church where the teaching of the Word of God is its central focus. And then number two, surrounding myself with people who are going to encourage me in the Word through whatever afflictions. Christians are good fighters. We're only good together. We're only good as a herd, right? We're terrible fighters when we're in isolation, when we're separated from the rest of the flock. We're designed to be the most effective and safest when we band together. Amen? We're a new Christian. You know, they come to Christ in today's day and age especially. But then they start to experience some of the persecution that comes with being saved. And then having a little more experience with the Lord, I can put my arm around that person and say, hey, it's okay. You're not going through anything that the rest of us haven't experienced and will continue to experience until our Lord comes for us. And then you can just take them through Scripture. Let me show you what Jesus said in John chapter 16. Let me give you some Scripture that points out the glorious fact that, yes, we're all going to suffer persecution. There's always going to be persecution that we have to endure on this earth. But let me show you how the Bible says it's all going to be worth it for the Christian. That's encouragement, right? That's taking that person and building them up and giving them truth straight from the source of truth. And if I neglect either one of those two things in my Christian walk, if I neglect the Word, or if I neglect the fellowshipping of the saints, then I shouldn't be surprised when my faith is continually being shaken all over the place like a dog wagging its tail. Okay? And as far as afflictions go, another thing that is comforting, and Paul wants to read the reader to know here, as I said, he says we've been appointed to afflictions. What is part of the normal Christian activity is you have an appointment with afflictions. As he says, verse 4, for in fact, we told you before when we were with you that we would suffer tribulation. So we make a grave error. Listen, everybody needs to be leading people to Christ. Lord's coming soon. Whole world full of lost people out there. We need to be telling people about Jesus. But we make a grave mistake and error when we lead someone to Christ under the premise that, you know, you accept Jesus and everything from then on out is going to be moonlight and roses for you. The Christian life, listen, I've tried everything. Many of you probably have too. And I can tell you from experience, the Christian life is infinitely superior to any other life on this earth, but it's not the easiest life. Not by any stretch. And people need to know that. It is the most rewarding life, but it's not the easiest life. Because it's hard to swim upstream. It's hard to go against the current, and the current is just getting stronger and stronger and stronger. Paul says, I didn't hide that from you when I led you to Christ. I warned you about the tribulation that accompanies faith in Jesus. He said, just as it happened, and you know. So I told you, Paul says, that Christians have been appointed to this, to affliction, and now it has happened, and it will continue to happen. So let that be a comfort to you. Paul says, James says that we should count it all joy when we fall into various trials. And you might be like, well, okay, hold on. Time out. You mean not only you're going to tell me, Pastor, I'm going to suffer affliction for the sake of putting my faith in Jesus Christ, but you're telling me I have to like it and that I should be comforted by it and I should find joy in the affliction? And the answer is yes, that's what I'm telling you. Because as it says here, I'm going to give you three reasons why we should find joy and comfort in the affliction when we're able to zoom out and look at everything from God's perspective and the eternal perspective. Three reasons. Number one, who has appointed us to these afflictions? God has. It's God who's in control. The devil can't do anything to me. My flesh, the world, my enemies cannot do anything to me without getting approval from God. And then God's going to take whatever that is, and he's going to use it for my good, Romans 8:28 tells us. All right, so it's God who's in control of what I am afflicted by, and I trust God with that. And then number two, the Bible tells us that those who partake in the sufferings of Christ will also partake in his glory. You're going to partake of his death? Bible says, hey, speaking of not being an easy life, what does the Bible say? It says, you're going to follow Jesus, you got a cross to pick up and carry with you. What is a cross? It's an instrument of death, right? So it's not an easy life. But if you're going to partake in Jesus' death, you're going to partake in his resurrection. That's the point. It's got this eternal purpose in it. Afflictions for the sake of my faith eternally identifies me with my Savior Jesus, who also was afflicted. And then number three, suffering also has a great purpose related to this side of heaven. I don't have to wait to get to the other side in order for, you know, all the suffering to pay off and to be something valuable in my life. In that the suffering, the affliction, one thing I can always say is it always strengthens my dependency upon God. How's your prayer life when you're walking on the mountain? I guarantee it's not as good as when you're in the valley. You know what prayer is? Prayer is just my declaration of my dependency upon God. The more I pray, the more dependent I am, or that I'm communicating to God, the more dependent I am upon him. And so, afflictions, they strengthen my dependency upon God and my intimacy with him. Now, I love mountaintop experiences with God, as we all do, and I've had many. But I can't think of a single time when things were going great in my life and I'm walking along with God on the mountain where I desired and pursued even greater intimacy in my relationship with the Lord. It's during times of trials and persecutions and afflictions where it's during those times where I've grown the most, where I've cried the most, where I've cried out to God the most, where I've depended on him the most, where I've developed a closer walk with my Lord. And listen, I don't want to pretend like I know the mind of God or that I have the authority to speak for God on this, but from a human perspective, it just seems like there are Christians who they're only able to maintain a close relationship with God when they're suffering. And if that's the case, listen, then your continued suffering is the best thing that God could do for you. Because intimacy with God is that's first and foremost. It's the highest priority that we have on this earth, in this life, and the next. Mel and I, we had this girl that we tried to minister to for years. And she was on this cycle of every time something bad happened, She'd be crying out to God, and she'd be on her face before the Lord. She'd be repenting and drawing back into closeness with the Lord. But as soon as the Lord would deliver her, she'd stop coming to church. And once again, she would distance herself from God and God's people. Some other affliction would then hit, and she'd be right back in church, back on her face. And this kind of thing, this cycle repeated itself many, many times. And this girl went through some rough stuff, I'm not going to lie. But finally she asked me one day, she goes, why do these things keep happening to me? And when are they going to stop? I said, maybe when you stop communicating to God, that you'll only love Him and seek Him and obey Him when you need Him to deliver you from something. Maybe when you seek Him and love Him and obey Him and walk with Him when you're on the mountain, maybe there'll be a whole lot more mountaintop experiences for you. I don't know. But sometimes God gives us the same test over and over and over simply because we've never passed it. The Bible says that God chastens those He loves. Now, the enemy's desire in the chastening and the affliction is to always, you know, to hurt me and discourage me, to draw me away from God through the affliction. But God's intention for them is that they would grow me up in Him. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10, the writer of Hebrews says this, for it was fitting for Him, for God, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, that's us, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. And then Hebrews 5:8, though He was a son, yet He learned obedience by the things which He suffered. So again, it's not that we get to become immune to afflictions. And you think about it, again, from God's perspective, that would be the worst thing that God could ever let happen to us. If it's the afflictions and the valley experiences that draw us closer to God, oh, how horrible that would be if God ever took those away. And so it's rough to hear. I don't like it. My flesh doesn't like it. But it's nevertheless true that we need afflictions. And the important thing is when the afflictions do come, I have to let them fulfill their heavenly purpose and their eternal purpose, and that is to draw me closer to God and develop a deeper dependency for His hand upon my life. Equally, I have to make sure that Satan's desire in the affliction, I got to make sure that that's never given any traction in my heart. Which his desire is just to damage my faith or to hinder my faith. And afflictions will have no negative effect upon my faith when as God's child, I have familiarized myself with God's word, surrounded myself with God's people. That's how I learn to endure the afflictions. That's how I learned to have the proper perspective. And this is important because Paul is giving a stern warning here, and he's writing to Christians there in Thessalonica. He's giving a stern warning about how easily it would be for our faith to be shaken if we don't have the proper perspective and attitude related to trials. When Jesus gave the parable of the soils, you'll remember how he described how there would be people who would fall away because of tribulations and persecutions. And so here's Paul. He's describing to the Thessalonians what was on his heart related to them when he was in Athens. He said, I knew you were suffering for the sake of having put your faith in Jesus. And Paul said, it was killing me, not knowing if that suffering was causing you to wane in your faith. He says, verse 5, for this reason, when I could no longer endure it, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter, Satan, had tempted you. And if Satan had succeeded in drawing away the Thessalonian church from their faith through afflictions, then Paul says, then I was afraid that our labor might be in vain. that all that we did, all the work that we did there, that God did in Thessalonica, has come to nothing. And what a shame that would be. And this was very concerning to Paul. But Paul says, verse 6, now that Timothy has come to us from you, Timothy's made his way back from Thessalonica to Corinth, and he said he brought to us good news of your faith and love. So not only had their faith not been hindered by the afflictions, they were allowing the afflictions to do exactly what the afflictions were designed to do, and that's to strengthen their faith, to build them up into build them up in the Lord, and to raise them up into spiritual maturity. And then notice their commitment to Jesus. Their faith was being evidenced. The sincerity of their faith was being proven by what? By their love. Their love for God and their love for others. Jesus said, John 13:35, by this all will know that you are my disciples, by what? If you have love for one another. Calvin says, faith and love is the sum of godliness. Faith plus love is the sum of godliness. And what good news this was for Paul to receive this kind of news from that church. And then on a personal note, remember the Judaizers had said some terrible things about Paul and had started some vicious rumors. And so Paul is relieved to hear that the people of Thessalonica, that they, regardless of what was being said about him, they still thought very fondly of Paul and had not believed the things that were being said of him in his ministry. As he says here, and that you always have good remembrance of us, greatly desiring to see us as we also to see you. Therefore, brethren, in all our affliction and distress, everything we're suffering over here, man, we were comforted concerning you by your faith. Now think back, if there's ever been anybody you've led to Christ and maybe you've lost contact with them, it's been a year, it's been 5 years or something, and then you see them and they're still just absolutely on fire for the Lord. What a great comfort and encouragement that would be. So Paul, when he wrote this letter to the Thessalonians from the city of Corinth, as I said before, it was one of the low points in Paul's life, at least in his ministry, in that Paul at this point in time, he was greatly discouraged and greatly distressed, as he talks about there in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. But it's during that time of great discouragement that Timothy comes to Paul in Corinth with this awesome news about what was happening with the church in Thessalonica and how uplifting that must have been for Paul. And as a pastor, I'm human, I'm not going to lie. Sometimes I find myself discouraged because not everybody responds to the word the way you would hope. But as a whole, this church is such a tremendous blessing in my life. And when I see how you give and how you serve and how you love, it keeps me encouraged and uplifted. It gives me the resolve to keep going, an even greater resolve to keep going. Once again, this church stepped up to the plate with the Walk for Life. Blew me away. I don't know. I mean, last year we thought we did really, really well. We were hoping to just even get close to what we had raised last year. Last year we raised this over $5,000 as a church. And, you know, we're a church of 200 people, and we're competing against churches of thousands of people and of, you know, many, many dozens of churches that were participating in this. We came in third place over all the greater Charleston area. Let me say, you came in third place. Let me rephrase that. But we raised over $7,500 this year. And I tell you, on behalf of all of the innocent babies and the innocent lives that are going to be saved as a result of your faithfulness, I say thank you. God says thank you. But this church's faithfulness, it gives me an even greater resolve to press on toward the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. We've gotten our land paid off down there on 61. We're about halfway to our goal of coming up with the down payment and everything that we need to hopefully break ground and to build soon. And so we got a lot of stuff ahead of us, but just know that your heart for the Lord is a great encouragement for me. Paul says, "For now we live if you stand fast in the Lord." In other words, I was down and out. But this good news concerning your faith and your love, you've put a spring in my step, Paul says. And you can just feel Paul wanting to leap for joy. And notice Paul doesn't take the credit for what happened in Thessalonica. He says, for what thanks can we render to God for you? He knew that it was God that did all the work. What thanks can we render to God for you for all the joy with which we rejoice for your sake before our God, night and day, and praying exceedingly that we may see your face. In other words, it wasn't satisfaction enough for Paul just to hear the good report from Timothy about the church in Thessalonica. He couldn't wait to go and see it for himself. He says, I'm praying night and day to be able to come to you. And he goes on to perfect or complete what is lacking in your faith. Again, they were still young in their walk. And there was still much for them to learn related to the word. And Paul says, now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus Christ, two persons viewed as one. Jesus said, I and my Father are one. And Paul says, yes and amen to that. May our God and Father himself, our Lord Jesus Christ, direct our way to you. And then the second part of Paul's prayer request, may the Lord make you increase and abound in love to one another, and then notice to all. Now, as I said, this church in Thessalonica was a loving church, but they still had a lot of growing to do in the Lord. And as you grow in the Lord, as your life becomes more and more directed by the Word of God, what is going to be the fruit of that? Is the fruit of that not going to be love? A greater love for God, a greater love for God's people? But then also, as he says, for all, that you would develop a greater love and concern for the lost. God loves lost people. God is greatly concerned for the lost people of the world. That's why he has us in the world. We don't become Christians and then we all move to Christian Island out in the Atlantic. You know, God has us in the world so that when we grow in the Lord, as we become more and more like him, so too will our love and our concern for people out there that he desires to save. Or people will say, and I've heard this said even in like Bible study circles, I've heard people say this, that someone will say, you know, I love God, but I just don't like people. But what did the Apostle John have to say about that kind of attitude? 1 John 4:20. John says, if someone says, I love God and hates his brother or does not prefer to encourage his brother, he says he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And by brother, he just means fellow man. And then there are those who, you know, they love, but they only express love toward family members and close friends, or that is people that love them. But Jesus said we are to love even our enemies. And that if we only love those who love us, how does that make us any different than the average lost person? You see, even the heathen loves those who love them. So as true faith grows, true love will grow as well in your heart. That's what Paul prays for the Thessalonian church. And then he's not afraid, notice, to set himself as a pattern or a role model related to the kind of love that God expects from each of us when he saves us. He says, love others just as we do to you. So as a teacher, Paul's like, this is not about do as I say. This is about do as I do. You can follow me. Look to me. Look at the way I follow the Lord. Follow me. Imitate me as I imitate Christ, Paul said. And then verse 13, so that he, God, may establish your hearts blameless in holiness. What is holiness? Holiness just means that you're being set apart from the world. It means you're separated from the world. You're separated from sin. You're separated from that bondage that you used to live under. You're separated from the flesh. So you're separated from these things that have to do with the flesh and the world, and you're separated to God. You're separated to holiness, separated to living according to God's word. And what part of the body is it that Paul focuses in on that he says needs to be set apart? The mind? The feet? The eyes? The ears? No. Those are all outer expressions. He says, establish your heart, the inner man. And then, as the old saying goes, you set your heart on the things of God, and your mind and your feet and your eyes and everything else will follow. So Paul's point is he doesn't want to create a bunch of outwardly religious people. Remember what Jesus called? He told the Pharisees, you're like whitewashed tombs. Where you're beautiful and shiny on the outside, man, you're glowing on the outside, but inside it's just rotten, dead man's bones. That's religion. God says that you may establish your hearts, the inner man, blameless in holiness from the inside out. And then he goes on, before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, have you noticed that every single chapter of the book of 1 Thessalonians closes with the reminder of the second coming of our Lord? And we're going to get into that next week in chapter 4. We're going to get into the meat of the letter here. But here, in context of the Lord's coming and what Paul's talking about in chapter 3, as I've said it before, I'll say it again, nothing compels a person to holiness more than the reminder, the constant attitude, or the constant revelation upon my own heart that Jesus is coming very, very soon, and maybe even today. You might not even make it home. I hope you don't in that regard. 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. It says, beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he, Jesus, is revealed, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him, what hope? Anyone living with a great anticipation of the coming of our Lord Jesus. John says, everyone who has this hope in him, what does he do? He purifies himself just as he, Jesus, is pure. In other words, he models his life after Jesus. Living with the mindset and the understanding that Jesus is coming any minute, it leads to holy living, is what Paul is saying. And then Paul gives us another great motivation for holiness by reminding us that when Jesus comes, he's not coming by himself. He's coming with a whole heavenly host, right? He's coming with all of us who have been raptured and who have just been in heaven for 7 years at the marriage supper of the Lamb and the Bema seat of Christ, and we're coming with all of our rewards and jewels and crowns and all, and we're coming as spectators of Jesus coming back to this earth as that conquering king who's going to judge this Christ-rejecting world. So he says here he's coming with all those who he has made holy, coming with all his saints. Only two kinds of people in the world, J. Vernon McGee says, the saints and the ain'ts. Now, me living in holiness is not what saves me. Only Jesus can save me, and only Jesus makes me holy through putting my faith in him and the blood that he shed for me for my sins on Calvary. But then I live according to holiness because he saved me, in response to my salvation, in response to God's grace, in response to God's goodness upon my life. in response to the best thing that's ever happened to me or ever will happen to me in all eternity. Man, if God was going to require eternal death for my sin, and Jesus came along and he paid that cost, he paid that price, he suffered that death for me so that I can live. If he died for me, isn't the very least I can do is live for him? I live according to holiness because I truly believe he's coming soon. Christians have this idea of, you know, okay, I love God and I can have God and I can have my sin and I can have this flesh and I can have all this other part of the world. But you can't live loving the Lord and believing that he's coming back soon and loving your flesh at the same time. You've got to make a choice. And if you're loving your flesh and you're pleasing your flesh and you're walking after the flesh, then you don't believe either that Jesus is coming or at least that he's coming soon. So, believing what the Bible says related to the end times and seeing the times, we don't have time to go into all of it, but we know that Jesus is coming soon. Trust me, I've spent 25 years studying prophecy and studying the Word of God and studying apologetics. And if I didn't believe it, I wouldn't be up here teaching it. But he's coming soon, and when he does come, I don't want him to find me in any other condition other than faithful. That's what John was communicating in 1 John 3. That's what Paul's communicating here in 1 Thessalonians 3, to which we all say yes and amen. Amen? Amen. All right, let's pray and we'll take communion. Father, we love you. We are just in awe of the fact that you gave your life for us, that you died for us, Lord, that we might live and be reconciled unto you. I pray that you would take what has been revealed to us through your Spirit, Lord, and that would penetrate our hearts and the very marrow of our bones, Lord, again, that we might be changed, that we might be moved out of places of comfort and out of places that we have sought to go after the flesh or anything to do with this world, Lord, that we might be drawn into greater intimacy with you, that you might make us a faithful church, a loving church, a church that desires to know your word and a church that desires to encourage each other in that truth. And so, Lord, bless us. Again, take your word and do great and mighty things in our hearts with it today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we thank you. We love you for just the opportunity to gather here today as your people, as your church. Would you bless us, Lord? Would you keep us safe? Watch over us this week. Bless our homes. Bless our marriages. Bless our children. Bless our church, Lord. Make us bright lights and beacons of your truth out there in the world, Father. And help us to be faithful with this beautiful truth in this gospel of Jesus that you have bestowed upon us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you've never accepted the Lord, if you need prayer, I want to remind you, available to pray for you and with you after service here. I'll be available down front. Don't forget, Ignite Youth going on here tonight at 6 p.m. This Wednesday, we have our men's and women's Bible study. Ladies, you can come. You have the choice to come at 9:30 a.m. or at 7 p.m., and then the men's Bible study is at 7 p.m. on Wednesday nights as well, along with Swordsman's Club and Nursery and all of that. Next Sunday, again, we get into the meat of Paul's letter to the Thessalonians, that 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and so can't wait to dive into that. Go ahead and read forward, and we'll jump in next week. Let's all stand, and we'll close. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. God bless you all. Have an awesome week. That's how you change
the world. Thank you for listening to Changing the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.